There is one thing worth mentioning today. As I was praying for help, which I certainly need help in my own fiscal cliff situation, I realized that I do not want to call anybody into this world. Would not want that at all. Not at all. Are you kidding? What if I was in the death-free paradise realm and someone said, you have to come here into this world because I need some help and you have to incarnate here. I wouldn't want to do that. Who would want that? So I certainly, golden rule, do unto others as you would want them to do unto you. There's no way in the world I would want to call someone actually physically into this world, say, I hope you're here physically. No way. So I said, look, I'll settle for a subtle appearance. Don't come into this world. Don't take incarnation. Please don't. Not for my sake. No way. And so I prayed for a subtle manifestation. So that's the route that I'm going. I see that now. It's not. People assume that Jesus coming back will be in the flesh and will be here. I don't know. I don't think so. I doubt it. I really doubt it. I really, really doubt it. I remember in the Course in Miracles that people, there was, he said something about that he wants his freedom too, and that he's enjoying the freedom of reality, just enjoying it immensely. And I got the feeling like he's not interested in coming back and taking another birth in the flesh here. No way. That's definitely the sense that I got from the responses and the context of it all. Was he saying, yeah, you're free to do what you want to do, but also I'm also free to do what I want to do. I also extend that freedom to myself. And I'm really enjoying my experiencing. So, yeah, I would say a subtle return, any return would be on the subtle levels, but not be a fleshy return. So we would need to somehow be able to relate on the subtle levels. Now, I asked myself, can I do that? I thought about it and said, well, yeah, sure, why not? Other people won't be able to see it. If something's subtle and you're attuned to it, other people say, what are you talking about? I don't see anything. But I don't know. That's okay. Don't have to prove anything. So I seem somewhat calm about the idea. And it just doesn't seem to rattle me. Right now, not much rattles me. For some reason, it's just whatever. This way, that way, whatever. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. It's all unnecessary anyway. The entirety of the situation is completely unnecessary. Except we have the necessity of recognizing the non-necessity of it. We do have that necessity. We cannot continue on forever engaging in something that's entirely unnecessary. We weren't created for that. So within us, there's this discontent, divine discontent within us, and we want to finish whatever, be done with it, one way or the other. Either we need this contingency plan of existence or we don't. And we want to get it settled. Which way is it? And of course, I say it's unnecessary. It's entirely unnecessary. That's how I see it. So it is necessary to recognize that it's unnecessary and to exchange it for the sake of continuity, another hypothetical of non-annihilation, which would be like an overlay, a blessing, existence in a perfectly blessed condition, as it were, paradise realm, death-free realm. That's where you would end up eventually from gravitating in that direction. The death-free realms. So again, why those who are in the death-free realms, just full of intense gratitude and being reconciled to the nature of reality, which is completely threat-free, why would they want to come back here to this world, which is nothing but threat? Why? Why? And then why would I want to be the reason why they came back? No way. Forget it. Don't come back on my account. That's how I feel. No way. So that leaves us with a subtle return. So I'm starting to turn my attention to that direction. That reassures us, actually, doesn't it? Because that reassures that when we go to the deathly realm, we won't be pulled back into this world either. That we can help others by having a subtle manifestation and not have to come back in this world. So if I'm able to dovetail with a subtle manifestation, I'll just prove that it's possible. And that means that if we want to help somebody from the death-free realm here, we can do it on the subtle level. It is possible, and it should be done that way. Nobody should have to come back here. Nobody. For any reason. No way. I want to make sure it's not necessary. So, that's the one important thing to say today. And we can expound on that a little bit. Super important. I'm expecting something subtle. That's what I asked for. I call it. I made the call saying, "Hey, let's just do it subtly. If there's anything happens, let it be subtle. Let it be subtle." And again, those kind of things may be something that only one person is aware of it or seeing it, and others can feel the presence of it, etc. But it might not be seen by all. But that might be a less traumatic way to deal with it. Could you imagine if Jesus came back in the flesh? What a circus it would be, I'm telling you. Be absolutely crazy, absolutely nuts. There are some who claim that they are Jesus in the flesh, but from how they teach, I assure you they are not. It would be very easily evident if it was actually Jesus in the flesh. The teaching would just be quite amazing, and just again the basics would be, you have no problem speaking the basics, and the basics are quite amazing. That is, of course, that nobody's even here at all. The same way we're not really in a dream. We're having this dream, we're running around the dream. We're not really the person in the dream running around. We're the person in the bed sleeping. The same way we're not in this dream at all. Nothing's in this dream. Nothing whatsoever. There's nothing here, and nothing has ever happened. And that's very important. Plus, it's all totally unnecessary. Very important. Reality will never change. It can't be changed. And of course, a change would mean an annihilation. So it's all completely unnecessary. This whole contingency plan of how to survive annihilation is totally unnecessary. And then, just that kind of ends all questioning, doesn't it? Whatever questions you have, it's just unnecessary. What about this? That's all. It's just unnecessary. There's no necessity to it. But, and then there's this other hypothetical we can exchange it for. And then that reconciles us to the threat-free nature of reality. How can we jump back into reality when all we know is threat? And in reality, there's no threat at all. We feel like we lose our identity. Because our identity is basically here in this world based on surviving threats. That's what our identity is based on. All the memories, that we have here of okay, I avoided this. This was really problematical. This was a trauma. I all that stuff. If you think at your life, my gosh, I look at my life and it's just like so unbelievably traumatic. Just a massive cascade of trauma, really. Some real subtle, others less subtle, and some not very subtle at all. And it's just a horrendous nightmare. And so you get the sense of identity about the one who's able to keep dodging all these terrible situations that, oh my gosh, I've had some amazing situations of terrible, that this I, that's surviving all this stuff. And so we're identified with this I that's surviving all this stuff. And you go to reality, there's nothing threatening whatsoever. Never has been, never will be. And the notion is cannot even arise at all. So where's your identity then? Where's the self then? You see? That's a problem, isn't it? So we think of the lack of continuity, we lose our identity. Because our identity is really based on, again, surviving. So it's good to go to the death-free realm, the threat-free realm, but it still retains the forms that we're used to experiencing as being threatened in a situation we feel as like a world where we're used to threat. So that's what I experienced when I went to the death-free realm, is I kind of walked around. I said, ah, this is a beautiful place. And then gradually it dawned on me that nothing here had ever been harmed in any way. There was no threat to anything. I said, whoa. And what it was a sense of identity. I felt like, oh my gosh, how can I maintain identity under these circumstances? That was the problem. But looking at it more closely, is if everything is pretty much like Earth-like in terms of the flora and the fauna and the birds and the animals and whatever is there, it's in a format that we're used to identifying with threat, and yet there isn't any threat. So it's kind of like an intermediate halfway house kind of step, really, is what it is. So we don't feel like we can get used to not really having a threat-based identity, but we still say, well, yeah, but it's not irretrievably gone. I mean, there's still all these forms here, and the concept is still possible, I guess, to consider. Whereas in reality, there is no concepts. There are no concepts in reality whatsoever. And threat is just a concept. It's just an imaginary play. And there's no such play in reality at all. So we would, the identity we're used to having, is not there. It's not there. There's no way to give rise to it in reality whatsoever. So because of this, we greatly benefit from an intermediate step, greatly benefit from it by dwelling in a place that is just like, wow, everything's wonderful. Look at that. And still you have a sense of a body. I don't know if it's a light body or some kind of just imaginary body, but that doesn't need to eat or sleep or suffer in any way. And yet you still feel, okay, there's a body. Those are forms. Everything's familiar. And you still have like a vague sense, perhaps, of some sort of bodily identity or form identity or some at least vague conceptual possibility or something. And then once you get used to that, get really used to it, and just say, I can get used to this, and just dwell in that, then it's easy to set that down too and recognize that you cannot change reality at all. And so you have to accept it as it is. And there's no threat-based identity, survival-based identity at all there. And you can't even, there's no concept of that either. So, but it would be quite a leap to go from where we are now in the world with this threat-based identity to accepting reality as it is. That would seem to be just a very radical transition, really. Now, Jesus tells us that it wouldn't hurt us actually at all. Yet, it seems as though it would freak us out or something. So we're not willing to do it. And I can understand that very well, because I was actually faced with that scenario at one point where I could see that if I just leapt, I would be back in reality entirely. I would accept reality as it is. And I said, whoa, it's possible, but it just felt like too radical of a leap to take. And Jesus confirmed that in A Course in Miracles, saying very, 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 very rarely, just maybe one or two exceptions in the whole of existence or something, it just doesn't happen that someone takes that leap. It is possible. It's he seemed to indicate that it maybe had happened maybe once or just very rarely that someone had just decided to leap straight with no intermediate step. But he said, the rest of us, forget it. You're not going to do it. And I was in that situation. I could see that, no, we won't really do it that way. So forget about that. And focus on the intermediate step, where you get a much, very diffuse sense of the threat-based identity seems to be so diffused and like an echo. It's like a memory. It's like, oh, it's a memory, but the memory still is kind of still there, because you see a tree and you say, well, the tree, it seems like it potentially it could be harmed, and yet it never has been. And so you think, wow, it's probably, there's nothing here to harm, probably never will be harmed. Probably never will be harmed. Whereas we're coming, the hypothetical we have now is that reality probably will be annihilated. Whereas we look at the real world and the paradise realm, we say, nothing, I don't think anything here will ever be harmed. And probably nothing will ever be harmed, because nothing ever has been harmed. And I don't see any possibility it ever will be. So you see, that's a different hypothetical, isn't it? Very different hypothetical, and from that it's easy to be translated back into reality, accepting reality as it is. we're already in reality. We're just not refusing. We're refusing to accept it as it is. We're believing it could be changed. And any change of reality, of course, would annihilate all of it. Totally wouldn't be any reality. It'd be nothing. Nothing at all. Because everything is reality. It's all one system. And everything is an integral whole. There are no parts. There are no aspects as far as functionality and the way reality is. It's that way everywhere. Always. So even a tiniest change and reality would cease to be. Absolutely cease to be. Can't be changed. Cannot. Even in the tiniest way. It would be annihilation. So, yet it never will be changed. There is no way to change reality. And we're simply believing that there is because we want to be prime creator, which would necessitate a change in reality. So it's that desire to be prime creator, is that idea we want to entertain and see and experience being a prime creator. That's what gives rise to the desire, our desire to change reality. And because we want to be prime creator, that would necessitate a change in reality. It would necessitate it. And a change in reality would be an annihilation of everything. So we say, well, we can't really be prime creator yet, because we got this problem of annihilation. If we try to do that, we would be faced with annihilation if we succeeded. Therefore, how can we survive annihilation? Let's work on that first. We have to work on that first. And then once we figure out how to survive annihilation, then we can change reality and become prime creator. So the idea of wanting to be prime creator always has to first deal with this problem of annihilation. So immediately, that when we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, immediately this hypothetical scenario arose of existence, we call it, which is threat-based, which is the attempt to survive annihilation. It's a contingency plan, and we want to figure out how to do this. And so, of course, we continuously, everything keeps dying here, and extending itself through reproduction, all that kind of stuff. And we've been working on this for a long, long time. And of course, we see it as a necessity. It's a necessity only in that if we want to continue to hold on to this idea of being prime creator, then it is a necessity to work on this. Of course, we'll never succeed. That's impossible. How could reality survive its own annihilation? That's impossible. But we can work on it. Sure, we can work on it endlessly. We can work on it for eons if we want to. And it's necessary as long as we hold this idea of one prime creator, because we have to take care. If we want to engage with this idea at all, it wouldn't require surviving annihilation. But since we cannot change reality in any way, we cannot become prime creator. Therefore, there is no need to survive annihilation because reality can't be changed at all. Therefore, there is no real necessity to it. There's no absolute necessity to it. The necessity is only relative to the idea of wanting to be prime creator, but not an absolute necessity of reality. It's not needed for reality at all. It's only needed for this one idea of wanting to be prime creator necessitates this horrible, hellish nightmare of trying to figure out how to survive annihilation. In other words, annihilation will happen, but somehow something will survive it. Somehow it survived, which is a completely self-canceling statement, isn't it? If annihilation occurs, there's nothing, by definition, there's nothing that survives it. So it's a contradiction from the very beginning. It really is. It's crazy from the very beginning. It doesn't stop us, though, from working on it. One of the ways as we try to do it is we try to say, well, we never were in reality in the first place. So a reality can be annihilated, but we're not children of reality. We're not there. We're in some other place. We're in the future. We're putting ourselves in this hypothetical, imaginary place called time, the future, time and space. And we say, no, that's where we are. That's where our kingdom is. And reality is not here. So reality gets annihilated, but there's still this place called the future. Of course, if you're dreaming a dream and you get killed during your sleep, and unfortunately, you meet your demise somehow, heart attack, whatever, does that mean the dreams continue on and say, wow, oh, the dreamer died, but here in the dream where everything's great, is that what happens, or does the dream stop? Of course the dream stops. No dreamer, no dream. So we're saying like, oh yeah, reality can be just completely annihilated, but that's okay, because this dream will continue on. What existence, everything will continue on. That's not a problem. Not realizing that existence is just a dream of spirit, and spirit is one with reality. So if a reality were annihilated, there'd be no more dream. So we think this dream is somehow separate from the dreamer. And this is very important that we don't connect the dream with the dreamer. That is what we keep refusing to do, connect the dream with the dreamer and see. Because if we did that, we'd realize, oh my gosh, if the dreamer were annihilated, this dream would be gone too, and so we wouldn't survive the annihilation. So in order to keep working on surviving annihilation, we have to not see that the dream is coming from the dreamer. We can acknowledge the dreamer. We can say, yeah, there is something there, but we don't acknowledge that this dream existence is coming from that dreamer. We don't. We can acknowledge spirit, but we say, no, existence is something else. It's self-creating. It's created itself. It didn't come from any dreamer. It didn't come from spirit. And so that way we can keep up this delusion that somehow if the dreamer and is annihilated, the dream will continue, and then we're working on how do we build the perfect utopia within this existence. And then we turn to the intellect, and the intellect becomes God, and the intellect's telling us how to do all this work and fashion all this stuff in existence. And we have a situation now where the world is under the spell of the intellect. The leaders are very much under the spell of the intellect, and so are the population. And of course, the intellect, what's it want to do? It wants to kill everything. It's ceaselessly, constantly saying, okay, you have to, let's simulate annihilation. Now, how are we going to survive it? Simulate, let's simulate. Let's keep simulating, keep simulating, keep simulating. Let's build this up and tear it down. How you simulate it? And the intellect is supremely insecure because it knows its task is impossible. It's futile and it's unnecessary. And it knows that it's totally stupid and worthless and useless and knows all of that, and it's terrified of that. So the intellect is ruthless in trying to suppress and get rid of anyone that doesn't bow and submit to the intellect and go under its spell. It's ruthless. It wants to kill all those who don't go under its spell, really. It wants to just annihilate them. And so we have a world situation where the world is under the spell of the intellect, which doesn't bode well for those who are not under the spell of the intellect, because the intellect feels totally threatened. And of course, those who are under the spell of the intellect, they think the intellect's God, and without it, they would have no identity and be annihilated. So when the intellect tells them, hey, these people over here, they're bad, they're wicked, they're going to cause, they're threatening, super threatening, you need to get rid of them, people will say, oh, okay, and like zombies, they'll do terrible things, carry out massacres, etc., just because the intellect tells them to do so. So it's an amazing time in the world where we certainly need a big boost, because those who don't want to submit to the intellect, they're under a lot of pressure right now. A lot of pressure, really. The world is not what it used to be. It didn't used to be so many people who were under the spell of the intellect. People still had common sense. They had intuition. They didn't feel. Some felt they didn't deserve it, the intellect. And now they're saying, oh yeah, we deserve it now. And they're jumping. They jumped in head first into the pigsty of the intellect. And those are the dangerous ones. The ones who have been with the intellect for a long time have recognized its limitations and its troubles, and they're not so enamored with it really at all. So wow, this you know, I was with the intellect for quite some time in previous lifetimes, etc. And you realize what a liar it is, what a deceiver it is, how futile it is, how weak it is. You start to see through the intellect. But for those who are just really getting into the intellect, as far as feeling like they really, they really deserve it. This is something like the prize that they've been wanting. It's like, you know, a new car to them. Just like a new house, new car. This is fabulous. The intellect, of course, promises them everything. Great glory and power and eternal identity. All this is promises. And so those who are not wise to the intellect become rabid devotees of the intellect and fall under its spell severely. If the intellect tells them, hey, we need to get rid of those people, they say, oh, sure, no problem, we'll do that, or we'll get somebody else to do it for us. They don't want to get their hands dirty with it, as it were. So we have a situation in the world now where there's a lot of very immature, a lot of severe juvenile immaturity in the world of those who don't see through the intellect's lies, don't see it through its pretense, and they're in power. They're in power, and they have all their devotees now who are just completely enamored with the situation, feeling that they're going to build this utopia. The intellect's going to help them build a utopia, and they'll have their kingdom will come to them. Of course, all they have to do is just get rid of all those who don't belong, yeah, right? Who don't belong. In other words, who are not under submission, under the spell of the intellect. So you have this very dicey situation. You have a John the Baptist situation where, who is that, the Salome or Salome or whoever, the one of the wives of, what king was it? I don't know. Was it Herod? I don't know who it was. It was one of those kings there, and the wife asked for one favor, and the king granted it, and then she said, I wanted the head of John the Baptist, because John the Baptist, of course, would not submit to the intellect, was not under the spell of the intellect at all. And the wife was very much under the spell and had visions of grandeur and glory and could not stand John the Baptist not submitting to this grandeur, this grandiosity, and just dismissing it and saying, no, that's not it. So she said, hey, give him, I want his head on a platter. And the king didn't want to. He said, no, this guy's not done anything wrong. And the king said, well, I promise, so I have to do it. We're at that same kind of situation now in the world. Where there are people who are wise to the intellect, saying, ah, the intellect's terrible, but they don't really know how to get free of it. And so they still, if someone pressures them, say, hey, you need to do the dirty work here, they'll probably still do it. You can't really trust those who have not strongly gone beyond the intellect. Cannot trust them. They're still weak. They're still very, very weak. Easily manipulated. We call those mama's boys, as it were, or those who seem like they're strong men, but really if the woman says, this is what I want done, they'll just do it. They'll cave. They'll absolutely cave. Not able to stand up to that kind of pressure. Even though they don't really like doing the dirty work, they're just not able to stand up to it. So you need those in the world who just say, no, I'm not going to do any dirty work. Forget it. No way. No how. You don't like those who have gone beyond the intellect? That's tough. Too bad. That's the price you pay for entertaining the idea of wanting to be prime creators. You have this hypothetical scenario, and you have in that hypothetical scenario, you have witnesses to truth, witnesses to the necessity of recognizing its non-necessity. You always have those such witnesses. You cannot ever be free of that. Cannot. So it's just simply tough love. You have to, if you don't like it, then recognize the non-necessity and you'll be free of this scenario. So there's no option. We don't have any option. We have to recognize the non-necessity of it eventually. So there will always be those in this dream who will not submit to the intellect, to the ego, who are gravitating towards recognizing the non-necessity of all this, always. And of course, those who want to be loyal to the intellect, they hate that. They really hate it. because they know it weakens the intellect. The intellect gets all jittery and nervous, and therefore their grandiosity, their future grandiosity, seems to be trembling and collapsing. House of Cards is collapsing, and it just freaks them out. They say, oh, their identity is collapsing, their future identity, with the identity they're working on building up. So it is dangerous. It is dangerous to just do not submit to the ego, the intellect, belief, the bully, the big bully of belief. It is dangerous in a way. And the times that we're in right now are incredibly dangerous times in one way, in certain ways. Again, although you have to consent to any harm. No, nothing can harm you unless you yourself feel that it's possible to be harmed and consent to it. Say, oh yeah, okay, it's possible. And that's another issue. Don't have any enemies, because if you can attack an enemy, it means you too can be attacked, because we're all one. So you're saying, yeah, I too, by saying that someone else is vulnerable, you're saying yourself is also vulnerable. Saying that they are a body, you're saying you too are a body. You can't have it both ways. You can't have your brother in spirit is a body, but you're not. That's impossible, because we're all one, share one reality. And if you choose that reality to be vulnerability, you too will be vulnerable. So if there's enemies you see and you want to kill them, you're accepting your own death, your own vulnerability to being killed. Where if you don't have any enemies, you say, no, I don't want to harm anyone at all, then you say, no, I can't be harmed either. I have no desire for myself to be harmed either. So it's very important to forgive, super important. You have to forgive everyone, because nobody's ever done anything to reality. No one's ever harmed what you are, really are at all. You're completely untouched by these dreams. So forgive everybody, and realize it's just been a foolish whim of non-necessity, and say that they're all invulnerable, nobody can be attacked, you have no desire to hurt anyone for any reason, and then you will accept the same for yourself, and you will be free of harm also. Very important during these times. Forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. Super important. It's super practical. Super practical, because whatever you feel somebody else can suffer, you are also accepting that you can suffer from the very same fate. Very same fate. And you will, of course, feel very frightened and defensive about that, and be a huge problem for you. Oh, it's cold out here. Incredibly cold. Whew. So you have that issue of forgiveness. If you're able to extend that forgiveness, then you will be you have protection. You absolutely have protection, and you can say certain things that others would feel scared to say. you don't want to get Salome angry at you. That's for sure. There's a lot of Salomes in the world right now, or however you want to pronounce it. A lot. And there's a lot of the kings, a lot of those kings who are too weak to withstand the importuning of a wife or whatever, and concubine or whatever, and they will do what they're told to do. Reluctantly, but they will do it. You see, so it's not a good time for as far as that's concerned. Not at all. It never is in this world, but it's a particularly bad time right now. Because the worship of the intellect, I think it's an all-time high. It's off the charts right now. It's off the charts. And the power that those who worship the intellect have is off the charts. The control is off the charts. They're in control of this planet. Very much in control. Like a cancer, it metastasizes and is extremely in control of the body. It's like that. Maybe the body externally still moving around, looks healthy, maybe a little kind of skinny and, you know, gaunt, little gaunt. Say, that person doesn't look too well, but they're still functioning okay. But inside, the cancer's metastasized to all the vital organs, and you know that it's curtains unless you forgive yourself for choosing this idea of wanting to be prime creator. And if you do forgive yourself, you are forgiving everyone else as well for choosing it. And then you'll realize that they cannot be harmed, and you cannot be harmed. And then literally cancer can vanish from your body instantaneously, actually. That's the power of forgiveness. Forgiving yourself, actually, is the most powerful forgiveness. Forgive yourself from ever believing that you were vulnerable. Because you are one with reality, and you believe you could change reality, which means you believe you could annihilate yourself. So forgive yourself for believing you could annihilate yourself. And if you forgive yourself, you've forgiven everyone else, all aspects of reality, which are all one, function under one nature of reality, for same nature of reality for all aspects. And so you say, I cannot annihilate myself. I forgive myself for even trying. And therefore, they cannot either annihilate themselves. They can't be harmed in any way. And so if they can't be harmed in any way, I can't be harmed in any way. Therefore, how can I possibly have cancer or have any harm come to me? It's not possible. So even your appearance here in the world would be healed at that point. And that's been demonstrated. That has been demonstrated. Nana Maima had metastasized cancer throughout her whole body that was just horrible. The doctors said they'd never seen such a bad cancer. And gave her like a day to live, really. She was under care of a very prominent doctor, head of a hospital. And I believe. And the doctor said, no, I don't see how she can live the night, really. He said he came in to give her a shot of morphine to ease the pain. And then he saw her suddenly straighten up out of the position of just not being able to move, straighten up, and a bright light flashed, boom, and saw some kind of form disappear, as it were. And he ran away in terror. The next morning he came in, and she was there in perfect radiant health, not a trace of cancer. And he noted that. Very prominent doctor. Yeah. Now I say, well, how did you get the cancer in the first place? Her explanation was that all illnesses have forms, subtle forms, and the subtle forms like to come and hang out with her too. So the cancer wanted to come and hang out with her. So she said, sure, whatever. I don't understand that explanation entirely. And then at some point it leaves. That's what she said. But now, I don't know, was that exactly? But the point is that the cancer left instantaneously. And that what's really behind it is recognition that nothing real can be harmed. And knowing that nothing real can be harmed at all. We can't be harmed. We don't need to can entertain the notion that we can be harmed. Even this appearance, we don't have to entertain that notion. And we can choose another hypothetical of non-annihilation and extend that. And then cannot be harmed. Jesus said no one could harm a hair on his head if it weren't given to them to do so, because of the demonstration that he was going to give here in this world by using his appearance to show that it was merely an appearance and not the spirit. The spirit and the flesh never become one. And this is a tenet of Christianity that I hear constantly, is that God became flesh. Well, first of all, there's one mistake there right off the bat, that Jesus is not God. Jesus is not the prime creator. Is not the prime creator. Jesus is the sonship. Is the spirit. What the prime created is not the prime creator. And he said that many times. I and my Father are one, but my Father is greater. That's very simple. How could there be any misunderstanding of that? And yet, the church teaches that Jesus is God. No. It's God the Son. There is a difference. Because Jesus didn't create himself. Prime creator created Jesus. See, that is, and Jesus didn't create the prime creator, but the prime creator did create Jesus. That's a difference, super important difference. So that's mistake number one. Mistake number two is to say that God became flesh. That's impossible, totally impossible. Spirit can never become flesh, totally impossible. Spirit cannot become vulnerable. Flesh is obviously vulnerable to everything. It's impermanent. Spirit can never be impermanent. Spirit can never leave reality. How can spirit enter into a dream and make the dream real? It's impossible. So Jesus had just had, his body was just an appearance. And he knew very well it was just an appearance. And when they say he became flesh, what really happened was supposedly Jesus took the appearance to be real for the point of demonstration. Supposedly, that's what they would say. I don't know if that happened or not. They say that for a minute he identified with the body to go through the crucifixion. I don't know. But identifying with the body is simply a mistake. I mean, he may have done it intentionally, but it doesn't mean that spirit became flesh at all. Spirit can't become flesh. It's absolute nonsense. So Jesus isn't the prime creator, and God, Jesus didn't become flesh. And those are the central tenets of the mystery. Of course, it's a mystery because it's not true. And it's a twisting, an attempt to accommodate the severe ambivalence we have to say that. It's like a magical solution. We're not flesh. Let's extend it out. We're not flesh either. We're not flesh at all. These fleshly bodies are just an appearance. They're imaginary appearance, like a hallucination, a mirage. We're not in this dream at all. So we've never become flesh. We've never been flesh. We've never even touched flesh. Flesh is just something in our imagination. It's a dream. We're imagining it. It's a hypothetical what if. When I say hypothetical scenario, I mean what if this could happen. What if? That's hypothetical, right? What if it could happen? Well, it never will. So what these bodies are basically saying, well, what if spirit could become flesh? Well, but they're not flesh now, and they never will be. But we can imagine what it might be like if it could happen that way. So that's why we have the confusion, because it's all about imagining, what if it could happen like this? What if it were possible? But it's not possible and never will happen. So there's no necessity to keep on this hypothetical what-if game. It's just a what-if game. We're just doing a what-if game. So maybe Jesus went along with the game and said, okay, well, what if I could be a flesh and then was crucified and then afterwards realized, yeah, but I can't. So let me resurrect the body and show everybody I really didn't become flesh at all. He didn't touch spirit. Spirit was completely unharmed. This is a little demonstration, a little show to clue you into what's going on. So that's possible. But again, no way can spirit ever become flesh. It's a what-if game. We're just playing this silly game, what-if game. And if we want to keep playing it, we can. Because even this exchanging hypothetical scenarios, we could say, well, what if there wasn't any hypothetical scenario? What if there wasn't the death-free realms? What if there wasn't an intermediate step? What if? We can always play the what-if game. Always. But why? It's completely unnecessary, and it causes us tremendous fear. Tremendous fear, which isn't fun. We don't like fear. No, it's not it's not what we're all about. It's not our cup of tea at all. And we're not clear enough about how it causes all this fear, how it brings this fearful state in us. It's just this horrible, insecure feeling of annihilation that we have. Of course, because we're saying, what if we could be annihilated? What if we could be annihilated? Then what would that be like? And how? And what if we could survive the annihilation? What would that be like? And we could say, well, the spirit became flesh, and now the flesh is life. And of course, then we feel tremendous fear, because, oh, wait a minute, this flesh is vulnerable, and the flesh dies, we'll be annihilated. So by trying to transfer identity into the flesh, we feel incredibly frightened that we're going to be annihilated. So definitely, it's very important to recognize it's all unnecessary unless we want to continue on with the idea of wanting to be prime creator, an idea which we actually dropped as soon as we picked it up. But the scenario arose immediately. The whole thing arose from that. And we still haven't resolved it. We need to resolve it. It's like a memory, that like a trauma that we haven't resolved yet. The trauma is over, but we haven't resolved it yet. And resolve it by the non-necessity and the intermediate step and clarification. and all of this stuff. And I'm working on resolving it. You're working on resolving it. And we'll keep working on it. And the big boost, when it comes, and I'm praying that it does come. Again, I'm now expecting it in a subtle form. Because, again, if you have Jesus here in the flesh, everybody's going to say, oh, God has become flesh, and he's here to rule over this new kingdom of his. And, oh, God, the craziness that will come about from that. No way will I be part of that. No way. Holy cow. That would just feed the feeding frenzy, the sharks. Just feed the sharks. And they say, you see, Jesus is God. Now he's come back. He's here in the flesh, and he's here to rule over this planet Earth, massacre all the bad people, get rid of them, institute new laws, set up the kingdom of heaven here on Earth. And this is our kingdom. This is our home, all that stuff. And just like, you know, just craziness, just off the charts, off the charts. Whereas if Jesus came in a subtle way, nobody saw him, other than those who are willing to accept him as he really is, then none of that would happen. People would just say, oh, you're crazy. And some crazy knucklehead who says that that he's subtly aware of Jesus or something, or someone like that. They just say, you know, just complete crazy knucklehead. So, but that's a lot better than the circus that would ensue. Oh my gosh, there may be a fake Jesus return in the flesh and everybody freak out and set up a kingdom. That's very possible. But the true Jesus, not here, not coming to the world to set up a kingdom. He already made it emphatically clear. He said, this world is not my kingdom at all. It's a kingdom of darkness. It's hell. They said, where are you going? He said, I'm going to my Father's kingdom. That's my home. That's where I dwell. This is not his kingdom. It's not our kingdom. This is a dream. It's a hypothetical what-if scenario. Why would Jesus come here to try to set up some kingdom within this hypothetical scenario? That's totally insane. It's nuts. He said he's going to prepare a dwelling place for us, meaning set up a facsimile of this planet in a threat, completely threat-free, maintaining the basic context of it for us, so we don't feel a loss of identity. And then he's going to come back and take us to that place. That's what he said. John 4, 1 through 14 or something like that. People can look it up. And that's what he said. And yet people are thinking he's coming back here to, with all the avenging angels, to wipe out all the bad demons, etc., and then set up the kingdom here in this temporary flesh-based world. Are you kidding? Who would want that? Who would want that? So, of course, it may be that there is some imposter Jesus show up in the world and say, they're Jesus, and everybody falls for that, and then they sets up a new world order, one centralized government kingdom here, and gets rid of all the quote-unquote bad people who are those who don't submit to it, etc., and people think that they're following Christ. No, they're not. They're following the Antichrist. They'd be following the Antichrist. And the world is well on its way to that, because it's worshiping the intellect, it's worshiping belief, it's getting ready to follow the Antichrist for sure. No doubt about it. So it behooves those who don't want to submit to the Antichrist to really tune into the true return of Jesus, which is a subtle return. True return of Christ, Jesus Christ, a subtle return. And Jesus Christ is just a term referring to God's plan of salvation and those who play the role in it. And specifically, it could refer to one who's, as he says, in charge of the plan of salvation as far as helping us out. But it also could include all those who have accepted the salvation for themselves and been reconciled to reality, accepted reality as it is. Ambassadors of certitude, ambassadors of the real world, ambassadors of paradise, all of those, it could include those too. Then they can be called angels or whatever you want to call it. It can be subtle presences from all different religions as possible. Jesus is not the only one who has accepted reality as it is, absolutely not. There are others too, but he's certainly playing a central role, at least in the Western world, it seems like, A Course in Miracles is a very powerful role, very powerful outreach, very powerful outreach. Very deep, profound teachings that just like, whoa, not easy to to get. I still don't get it, but I'm not so bothered by it, my fact that I don't quite get it. I get some of it very well and others I don't get, but I'm not really that bothered by I don't get all of it. I say, well, you know, it's okay. That's okay. The fact that I don't get all of it, clearly that's okay. It's not a problem. I don't feel so perturbed by it anymore. It used to bother me. That's the intellect. The intellect says, how come I can't get this? Another point about the intellect. Very important, because I always say that familiarity is the key. It's your ticket out of here. It really is your ticket out of here. The intellect is not your ticket out of here. The intellect hates familiarity. It works day and night to prevent you from taking that path. Guaranteed, that's what it does. And what the intellect tells you is that it can easily understand any teaching at all, boom, like that. And you only need to spend like a 5 minutes or something. And so the intellect says, don't worry. Eat, drink, and be merry. You can be entertained, whatever. Distract yourself. You don't have to work on that stuff at all. The intellect says, no, when the time comes, you'll be able to get it just like that. It'll be no problem for you, guaranteed. The intellect tells everyone that. And so that's why people don't take the path. They don't even start. They just watch television all the time, or just waste their lives, because they believe what the intellect has told them, that when the time comes where they really need it, piece of cake for them. Piece of cake. After all, the intellect knows everything, knows all, right? So how could it be difficult? The intellect says, how could it be difficult? I'm all knowing. It's not going to be difficult. And then when they get to that point, and they try to do it, they realize, oh my God, I don't know what's going on. I'm afraid I might lose my identity. What is this thing? It's like, I'm not familiar with this. I haven't thought about it. I haven't thought it through. And it's like, whoa, freak out, complete freak out. They can't do it. They can't do it because they don't have familiarity. So a certain sign that they're those who have gone beyond the intellect is that they've worked on familiarity. They're willing to do it. And that's something I have done. All out since 1978, and even shifting into a higher gear since 1997, of what might be a severe emergency mode of just pressing, just like full on sprint, just beyond a sprint. And of course the intellect hates that. It hasn't been easy, because the intellect says, what are you doing? What are you wasting all your time? You're ridiculous. You're stupid. You should be doing something else. Why are you going through this stuff again? You've gone through it 100 times already. What's the matter with you? And I just keep doing it, just driven and determined to, because I know familiarity is the key. And the intellect constantly tells me, hey, just give it up. You don't need to do that. Like tonight, it said, you don't need to tape. Come on, you've taped enough. What are you doing? What are you taping again for? That's crazy. That's nuts. Ridiculous. And I'd say, well, yeah, but look, January 1st, 2013 is coming up. Fiscal cliff is coming up. My own fiscal cliff is coming up at virtually the same time. And the world is under the spell of the intellect. When things go bad, they're going to go bad real fast. We're at a super difficult time now in history, and the opportunity is great. And, you know, some people are listening to the videos and hopefully getting something out of it. And I need to do the very best that I can do. And so even though it's freezing out here, I'm still going to do the best I can. I'm real tired. I didn't know if I could do a good job, but I'm going to try. And the intellect says, ah, there he goes again. Who does he think he is? Must be an egotist or something. Because he wants attention, because he keeps trying. So the ego tries to smear you. It tries to stop you. It tries to shame you. It tries to call you names and say that, you know, who are you? You think you're so great. You keep trying so hard. You know, why don't you be like everybody else? They're not trying hard. They believe in the intellect. They believe they can get it easily. And so why are you doing this? You must want to be better than them or something. All this kind of nonsense. You must want to be separate from them. Blah, blah, blah. Of course, it's those who want to be prime creator that have a sense of separation, feeling that the reality would be annihilated. Those who want to give up the idea of being prime creator, they realize nobody's ever left reality. There's never been any separation at all. So it's ridiculous. The intellect's got it backwards, of course. But you have to put up with the stuff on the path. The intellect constantly is trying to demean you, trick you, keep you from working on the path. It tries to keep you, and it keeps telling you, you should be able to get it like that. You should be able to get it. Boom. What's the matter with you? Why are you working on it again? You just worked on it yesterday. How come you don't have it yet? What's the matter with you? Like that. And so it's tough. And you say, yeah, I worked at it really hard yesterday. I thought I'd get it, but I didn't quite get it. So it means I don't quite have it yet, so I need to work on it really doubly hard today. And the ego say, you're just wasting your life, totally wasting your life, and what a fool. Again, defending its own position, because if it allows you to work on familiarity, it knows it's finished. It knows that it is finished. It knows that familiarity will KO the intellect. That's it. That's the kryptonite for the intellect. It is the kryptonite. Familiarity is the kryptonite. So it does everything possible. It will, flatter you. It will flatter you. It will try to say, oh, you're too smart for that. You don't need that. Why? There's people who are kind of dull do that kind of stuff. You're a lot smarter than that. You don't need to work that hard. Stuff like, it's terrified of familiarity. It's terrified of it. Because it knows it's curtains for it. If you keep on getting more and more familiar, it's really curtains for the intellect. So it pulls out every trick in the book to try and prevent you from doing that, which is why it's so difficult. You say, well, where's all these enlightened beings, those who have accepted reality as is? Where are they? I mean, it don't seem to be very many. Well, it's because not many continue on with familiarity. Just keep grinding it out day after day after day. Because the ego key will find some way to distract them, flatter them, shame them, whatever it takes. The ego, the intellect will utilize whatever it takes to try and derail the efforts towards familiarity. Absolutely will. And so it is not easy to persevere. Jesus said, I think in Matthew, said, he who persevere to the end shall be saved, right? What does he mean by that? Familiarity, of course. Those who continue, like he said, a cow chewing its cud, those who continue on like a cow chewing its cud with getting familiar every day, keep persevering all the way to the point where they're able to exchange hypothetical scenarios and be reconciled to the death-free realms, accept the death-free realms, the problem-free, threat-free realms. And then, of course, and then they will be reconciled unto the nature of reality. Those are the ones that will be saved. Those are the ones who will do it. Those who persevere, which is familiarity, of course. If you get it every day, you do everything you possibly can. I can honestly say I never miss a day. In some way, I used to, like, I wouldn't go to bed until I had made an extra effort. And I'd be real tired. I'd sit there and say, you know what? I just don't feel like I've done quite enough today. I'm going to put another half an hour, whatever, before I go to bed. I refuse to go to bed, or I refuse to go to sleep. Or sometimes if I went to sleep, I'd wake up early in the morning and say, wait a minute, I really need to make amends. I need to spend a lot of time. And just kind of like a workaholic on the spiritual path. If you're a workaholic on it and you just keep on working on it as much as you possibly can, wherever you are, just continually do it. It's like it's just all important to you, more important than breathing. If you keep doing that, then you keep persevering, then you will eventually feel so comfortable with what is needed to do, you will end up doing it. And you'll be saved. But again, if you let the intellect flatter you or trick you or derail you somehow and you stop, then that gets problematical because you start losing familiarity. So you need to persevere, you need to keep your efforts ceaseless. It's super important to do that. And if you break the chain of it, something, just get back to it, and it'll rapidly become familiar to you once again. It'll take a little bit of time. It takes me a little bit of time. When my mind drifts away, to get back to it, I feel a little bit unfamiliar, I'm not sure I can do this. And then you do it, and you say, oh, okay, this is very familiar. I'm in familiar territory. But rapidly, we forget our familiarity can be rapidly forgotten here. It's amazing. At least it seems that way. But just if you make a strong effort to get back to it, you will find it's there again. Say, it hasn't left me. It's still there. like riding a bike. If you quit for a while, you think, well, I'm not sure I can ride it again. I hadn't ridden a bike for years, and I had the bike here, and I said, I'm not sure I can ride it. And I think I can, but I'm not sure. And I got on, and I said, oh, okay, it's not so bad. And very quickly, I was riding it again. So be the spiritual nerd, you know, who just keeps on keeping on. That's, be a spiritual nerd, okay? These electronic gadget nerds, that's not where it's at. It's not where it's at all. Be a spiritual nerd. I was really a spiritual nerd. I was the ultimate spiritual nerd. I was reading super advanced stuff when I was a kid. In sixth grade, fifth, as soon as I could read, I was just reading, trying to read spiritual philosophy, spiritual teachings of all different types and traditions, and I've kept that up just constantly, and was always had my nose in a book of some very, I kind of hid it, you know, didn't want anyone to see what a nerd I was, what a spiritual nerd I was. I wanted to be like a jock or an athlete. I tried to build up an image. I'm just I'm not a spiritual nerd at all. I'm really this really great guy who's very socially acceptable and viable in society, etc. But nobody bought it. Nobody bought it. I couldn't. No matter what I did, nobody bought it. It's pretty amazing. I guess people are pretty sharp. They say there's something nerdy about that guy. And for me, I didn't like that because I didn't want to be seen that way. I didn't see myself as a nerd at all. Not at all. I felt very serious, purposeful person. I felt myself to be very profound and very serious and very dedicated and having a lot of very good qualities. I didn't see myself as being a nerd at all. But socially, from the standpoint of being socially social status, other people saw me as not having any social status. They said, this guy is not going to go anywhere. That's what the intellect told them, of course. The intellect said, hey, this guy, something wrong with him. He's not going anywhere. Better stay away from him. So, of course, it made it easier for me to keep on studying when everybody sort of stayed away from me. So I was this, you know, thick glasses, spiritual nerd who maybe at lunch break would be reading Autobiography of a Yogi or Be Here Now or Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment or more the Arantxa book or Theosophy, the Alice Bailey's Theosophy books and all sorts of esoteric stuff and New Age thought and historical Christianity and all these things. I'd be reading and studying all this stuff constantly from a young age. When people tell me that young people don't know anything or can't make decisions about spiritual matters, that's totally untrue. Totally untrue. I was actually more clear when I was young than I even am now in a lot of ways. I may be less naive now. But certainly as far as vision and clarity, and when I was young, it was very, very strong. And young people absolutely can choose to accept reality as it is, can be enlightened, can absolutely. A lot of them are clearer than their parents, for sure. So the parents always say, if I choose that, what am my children going to do? Well, your children probably will choose it before you will. That's a fact. My gosh. A lot of children look at their parents and say, oh my gosh, what am I going to do with them? You know, they're just really out of it, totally out of it. Because their seeing is somewhat clearer. They have not yet taken on the threat body. I think Eckhart Tolle calls it the pain body. The threat body, as it were, where the threat-based identity has not coalesced and crystallized so much. And mine did not until I was about 12, I think. It finally had so many severe traumas that it kept working on it to get that identity in place. It's like, what's wrong with that guy? He doesn't seem to have a threat-based identity, which I really didn't when I was younger. I really didn't have so much of a threat-based identity, and I resisted it. I said, no, nothing bad can happen. And I just had a very, very confident air that everything is going to be fine, perfect for me, etc. But and they said, wow, this guy is just, his imagination is too strong. He needs to have a real good trauma and a bunch of traumas, which I did. Severe, severe stuff. People threatening to murder me as a child, really, if I didn't accept the trauma-based identity. Absolutely. That those kind of things do happen to children. It happened to me. Absolutely happened to me. Where those whose teaching was upside down and backwards, and those who believed that Jesus was God and that Spirit became flesh, etc. And I said, no, that's not true. It's not true at all. They threatened to kill me when I was young, and almost did. And I had to repent to save my life, actually. And there are other situations too where people wanted to kill me just because they couldn't stand the certitude and what I said was true. The intellect freaked out. Absolutely, the intellect just freaked out and said, "Off with his head!" And then I said, "No, you can't harm me." But it was kind of traumatic. I couldn't quite handle those situations as a child. It's pretty doggone difficult to handle those kinds of situations. It takes a very rare bird to be able to handle those things without any fear whatsoever. And so eventually, it got to me. But I kept reading. I knew I had lost my clarity, as it were. And so I just read, kept reading. And I knew that at some point this great curriculum had come into the world. I knew it. So I kept going. Otherwise, I probably would have committed suicide, really. But I knew that there's this great curriculum that was going to come in the world, and it was going to be very helpful for me. And that I came across, it was A Course in Miracles. I knew, boom, right away, this is it. This is what I knew was coming. I knew that in advance. It was going to come in the world. I was spiritually informed about it, very aware of it, before it even became available. And so that kept me going. Without that, I couldn't have kept going. No way. No way. I was in way too much trouble. And then when that I came across, I said, I know I'm going to get free. I'm going to reclaim my clarity. And know once again what is true, but also was informed it's going to take a while, a lot of work, and it has. It absolutely has taken a long time, because the situation here is really—it's extremely difficult. That's why there's very few come into the world and retain their enlightened condition all the way through. Ananda Maimon was one. It's very difficult. Because the world here rejects it entirely, totally rejects it. Ananda Maimon did it by just simply accepting whatever that she was crazy. She told everybody she was crazy. That's what she did. Now, I didn't do that. You see, that would have been a lot better thing to do. And for me, I just said, no, I'm right. No, what I'm saying is right, and you're mistaken. And that just freaked them out. But if I just said, well, I'm sorry, I'm very sorry that I say these things, but I'm mentally defective, that's why I say these things, then they might have left me alone. That's what Ananda Maimon did. She said she was mentally defective. Everybody thought she was, and she just didn't correct them, and she just played that game that she was very mentally defective. She didn't cry when she was born. People got really worried about that. So as she grew up, everybody thought she was so quiet and still. Everyone thought she had some kind of brain damage. She was mentally defective. And so she just said, yeah, I'm mentally defective. And they let her alone that way. You saw this crazy little girl. She's cuckoo, poor girl. The relatives are so worried about her. They said she'll never get married. She'll just be a burden to the family forever. What a shame. And then didn't work out that way. It was difficult for the relatives to accept her because they thought she was mentally defective. And then all these like heads of state and very important VIP people and super aware, famous spiritual adepts and everything came were bowing to her and saying, this is incarnation of divinity itself. And her relatives are saying, what's going on? This little girl, she's crazy. She's mentally defective. What are you talking about? And they had a real hard time dealing with that. So to some extent, I tried to protect my family, relatives, etc. by not doing that. I just couldn't do that because it would have freaked them out to think that I must be mentally defective. So if divinity comes into the world in the flesh, it's really important to be in a situation where mental defection is like seeing that, well, it's okay and nobody really does anything about it, just let it be, which is in Bangladesh and in Kiora, where she was born, that area of Bangladesh now. Nobody really took her to see doctors or thought they could do anything about it at all. They just said, well, live and let it be. It's too bad. It's a shame. It's a tragedy, but it is what it is. Just let it be. And so they didn't bother her. Whereas now, if you're seen as mentally defective, you're going to have a team of therapists and drugs and everything in the world is going to be employed to try to set you straight. So you can't really play that card here, unfortunately. So I couldn't really play that card. I had to say, no, I'm fine. Everything's perfect. I'm very clear-minded, and this is truth. This is true. And that teed people off. It really teed them off. And if I would have said, I'm just speaking gibberish, I'm just mentally defective, you have to excuse me, I've been this way since birth, and there's nothing can be done. Then they might say, might spit on me or something, or just might just leave me alone. Leave that idiot alone, he's crazy, leave him alone. Stay away from him. But I still had some desire to be, not to be ostracized like that, or not to be completely alone or feel that way, whatever. So I wasn't able to play it the right way. So then I did get pressured in severe ways to the point of losing my life if I didn't conform and accept this pain body threat based identity and all this kind of stuff. And so that's why I've been so delayed in getting to speak truth and share truth here in the world. And most of us are delayed our entire lives, as a matter of fact. Almost everybody is delayed their entire lives. Very few are able to finally shed that trouble. And of course, when they do, well, how it goes after that is quite an interesting story. Not just for them, but for those who come to see them, it's not easy, because those who come to see them are like saying, wow, this is kind of, I don't really want to drop my threat-based identity. It seems very dangerous. And it can be. And if you do it, then people say you're crazy, you're nuts, and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, it's not easy in this world, and yet we are faced with a situation which is also not easy. In fact, it's even worse, which is submitting to the intellect. That's even worse. Terrible situations coming up. So pretty much we have to do what needs to be done to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is, to exchanging the hypothetical scenarios, to recognizing the non-necessity of existence. We have to do that. And if people want to say we're nuts or something, there are ways to just brush that aside, really. They have to work on acceptance is what it really boils down to. They refuse to work on familiarity, and so we're at the point now where it's too late for that. It really is. They can't spend 30 years at this point. It's go time. It's tea time. And we're on the tee. And when you're on the tee, you got to tee off. You can't just sit there and talk. You got to tee off. So what they can work on is acceptance. So that's the burden that has to be placed on them. And if they try to call you crazy, say, no, you have to work on acceptance now. You didn't work on familiarity, which is really the key. And now you've got the last gasp. What you can do is work on acceptance, which will actually help you greatly. But you have to do it. In other words, you have to accept that there's something beyond the intellect, and that there are those who will not submit to the intellect, and that there are those who recognize the non-necessity of this hypothetical scenario, those who will choose a new idea, those who realize that no one's ever left reality. There will be those in this dream who do that, and they have to accept it. They have to work on accepting that fact. The Indians were good at, in India, they were good at that. They had enlightened beings there. They would just say, well, this person, I don't understand. They may be crazy, but I accept them being here. I accept that this is necessary. So there's a kind of a cultural acceptance. Here in the West, there's not that cultural acceptance. So it's not easy for anyone here to accept that anyone here could be truly beyond the intellect, truly be liberated, truly be free of suffering, truly recognize the non-necessity of all this. Who can do that? They don't think it's possible. They think it's just nuts. Because the intellect tells them it's nuts. Of course, we're so enmeshed in the intellect here in the West, unbelievably worshipful of the intellect, where we're willing to cast common sense aside and follow the crazy utopian ideas and ideals of the intellect here in this world, build a better world, as it were, build a utopia here, make everything fair, equal results, all this kind of, they're willing to throw all common sense out the window and follow that as if it were some kind of religion, a cult. It's really a cult. And those who disagree, they see that they must be nuts, they must be crazy. But really, so sad to see the Western, the United States, for example, and many Western countries in that situation where they don't have any acceptance for those who are, will not submit to the ego, to the intellect, to belief, and who are willing, ready to exchange hypothetical scenarios and be reconciled unto the nature of reality. They won't accept it. They will not accept it. And they'll just say that they're insane, they're crazy. That is really tragic. And yet they have to accept it. They have to accept it. Otherwise, they're the ones who are going to end up being insane and crazy, worse than they already are. It's a great opportunity for them. Will they take it? I doubt it. I really doubt it. But it's possible. It's not, I wouldn't rule it out entirely. Okay? And I still hold out hope that some would. But, and in some instances, they will. You'd be surprised. Maybe we'll be surprised. Maybe we'll be surprised. But in other incidents, oh boy, the loyalty has been so extreme and the indoctrination so extreme to the intellect that they will just do what the intellect tells them to do. And of course, they will spout off all sorts of nonsense saying, how crazy you are. You're going to your destruction. You're going to your death. You're going to your annihilation. You don't know what you're doing. You need help. All this kind of stuff. That's what the intellect will tell them. Tell them this is how you should see it. Of course, they don't see it at all because they're not even looking. They just take the word of the intellect to say the intellect will tell them, this is how, what's happening. This is how I want you to see it, and this is how I want you to react. I want you to react to it this way. So you react to it that way without even seeing what's going on. Such is the world. Such is the world. At this time, more than ever. So, into that situation, here we are, and we need to keep advancing fast, fast, fast. My situation has always been very, very difficult, extremely difficult. Still remains so. It's just. But it seems as though at some point there will be a bridge crossed, and the big boost will come, and I'll play my role in that big boost. And at some point you have to draw the line and say, look, it's acceptance time now, because the time for explanation has come and gone. I've been here my whole entire life willing to explain to anybody who wanted to ask, all willing, and nobody ever asked me. Nobody ever asked me. Amazing, huh? Amazing. Nobody's ever asked me to explain anything to them. And yet the willingness has always been here completely. If anyone just asked, I would, of course, I'd explain to them what I know. Share. The willingness to share has always been here. No one's ever asked. So that just shows you this. The world is really, wow. That's the nature of the world. So, but the time for explanation has come to an end, because it's go time. It's tea time now. Because the net that the intellect is drawing up is going to ensnare you if you don't decide to sidestep it. So it's time now for actual, the big boost to actually happen. And from that, at that point, then everyone will be faced with a situation of acceptance. They'll either accept it or they won't, because there'll be something concrete there that they need to either accept or not accept. It's not. It will be more concrete than an explanation. An explanation is theoretical, and it will now be concrete. There will be evidence of a big boost happening. There will be something really profound that they cannot deny, and they either have to accept it or not. If they say, well, we don't accept this. We think this is demonic. We think this is terrible. It's going to annihilate you. It's wicked, blah, blah, blah. The intellect will tell them that that's what it is, and then they'll judge it that way. And that's a shame. It's a shame. It's a shame. And it almost breaks my heart. But what can you do? What can you do? Their time will come. Their time will come. And in the meantime, they will work on trying to overcome annihilation, which is no picnic. That is for sure. It is no picnic. Suffering's terrible. And see, if I could do something, I would. But you can lead a horse to water. You can't make him drink. You absolutely cannot make him drink. You just... And you have to be careful how you use empathy. You get very careful, very careful. You don't want to do something foolish that is harmful to you or them, that sets them back. You cannot use empathy that way. So you have to use some tough love, saying, look, this is what it is, it is what it is, and you have to ask yourself if you can get, maybe if you work at it, maybe you can get used to it, if you work at it, maybe you can have some degree of acceptance. That would be the best thing possible now, because the whole thing about, you see, the thing about explanation is the ego intellect tells them, oh, they should be able to explain it in 5 minutes to you, and if they can't, there's something wrong with them, leaving out the issue of familiarity entirely. Totally leaving it out. The issue of familiarity is way more important. So in other words, the time for explanations and familiarity has already come and gone. The last 50 years have been all important. And if they didn't use any of that time for familiarity, it's too late. It's too late. It's too late for familiarity for them. Because the dominoes will start to fall now. And the big boost has to come. And there has to be something very concrete here, very profound, and then at that point, it's not a matter of explanation, it's a matter of acceptance, because explanation rests on familiarity. Explanation without familiarity is useless. Useless. You have to be willing to get familiar with the explanation. There's no other way around that. None. The intellect insists that all it needs is the explanation, that's it, which is insane, totally ineffectual. So, when the profound profundity of the big boost is here, then people will be faced with acceptance or not. They'll have to accept it or not. And they're saying, well, can you explain it? No, cannot explain it, because explanation rests on familiarity, and there's no more time for familiarity. So they will have to work at the level of acceptance, which is difficult, which is not easy, but it's not impossible. Or they can, some level of acceptance, some level of allowing it to permeate in some way. Maybe it won't permeate all the way, because the explanation, they don't have familiarity with any explanations, but they can at least catch something, say. So we'll see how it goes. We'll see who can accept it. That's the next phase. That's the big boost. That should come soon, very soon. Because the net is going to be drawn in and pulled in very soon to catch all the fishes in the intellect and its mad, grandiose visions of what it can do. So, and I go in and I'm going to go in and thaw out, as my hands are like ice. But again, that just shows you familiarity, got to work at it. Whatever the situation, keep working at it. Don't let anybody waylay you. Don't get waylaid. You have to be sometimes very adamant, very firm. Sometimes people think you're impolite. You just have to be very firm, kind, civil, firm. Say, no, I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to do this. I'm just going to stay here. And then I just work. I don't go to social events. I don't do anything, really. I just work on this. And people must think, oh, well, what's wrong with him? He's antisocial or whatever. No, not at all. I'm fine in social situations, but I just feel antsy because I say, I need to get back to work. Come on, time's wasting. Got to get back to work. I got to get back to work on what? Familiarity. And they say, what are you talking about? You read that book? Didn't you read that book 5 years ago or something? I said, yeah, but I've read it, a thousand times since or something. And they said, why would anyone want to do that? That's crazy. Well, didn't you understand it the first time? I said, well, not as good as I understand it now. I was not as familiar with it the first time as I am the thousandth time, right? And they say, well, why do you need to be so familiar with it? Ah, very important question. Because there's a necessity for decision at some point. And then actually moving into where the decision takes us at some point. And there needs to be familiarity with that in order to feel a sense of continuity. All important. Continuity is all important as far as we're concerned. So familiarity gives you a sense of continuity. So you don't feel like you're just leaping into the abyss. You see, that's why it's super important. Super important. And a viewer pointed out that it has been 40 years since the Course in Miracles. The Course in Miracles came out in 1978. Very good insight. And the idea of this 40-year span is very significant, spiritually significant. That it's a time of fruition. It's a time of something becoming viable. It's a time of the big boost, as it were. And this is now, year 2013 is the 40th year since it became published officially for purchase, with a copy, you know, being published to the public, so the public could buy it at large. 40 years, very interesting. And I have a feeling that this big boost will be tied into that in some way, and it will happen. It will happen this year. Really, of course, I'm not a prophet. Don't know for sure, but it certainly would not be the slightest bit surprising if it came about, even if it came about very soon, at about the same timing as the fiscal cliff on January 1st and all these changes and the new healthcare law and all this radical, extreme changes and efforts to push through a utopian society, etc., is going to really kick off, and it's just going to go boom, 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 boom. There's going to be so much change and turmoil just off the charts, and so the big boost should come in now. But okay, if it doesn't, all right, if it comes now, it's great. If it doesn't come now, okay, I'm not going to sweat it too much. Keep on going with familiarity, and that'll be great. All right, that's it for this video. I'll go thaw out.